Good afternoon, everybody. Respected Mr. Jha, Mr. Sudhendran Kulkarni, students who took part in this little, I won't call it a competition, but a little effort in doing something for the city, contributing in terms of ideas, citizens, and friends. In fact, I was told by Mr. Jha and Mr. Sudhendran Kulkarni to talk about the emerging challenges in governance or re-emerging governance. The first thought that struck me was that in 1984, when I joined the service, governance was a bad word. Because governance meant government, and government was something which didn't work, which was not sensitive, and therefore governance was bad. So when you spoke out governance, you were actually using a bad word. Now suddenly, 33 years on down the line, when I sit on the dining table with my daughter, son, a daughter-in-law, son-in-law, and a little grandson, and I hear them converse, I suddenly find governance is a good word. And I turn around and say, now why is governance a good word? I say, come on, Dad, you won't understand. This is corporate governance. Oh, this is corporate governance. So corporate governance, but it's still governance. And that's become a good word. So suddenly we've reimagined the whole world governance from governance which the government did, governance being connected to the government, which was bad, to corporate governance, which is good. Now, what has happened? What is it that has suddenly happened that you hear people saying, oh, well, governance is good? You look back into history and see what happened to governance. In fact, if you look at historically, when societies started living and societies formed and people started living a stable life, they moved from collecting forest produce to actually doing agriculture and stabilizing. The governance started there. But then it was the rule of the king. One man, a woman, he or she decided what you did, and that was right. There was just no debate. So the king said, do this, and that's correct. And the king said, don't do that, and that was also correct. So governance was just one man and what he dictated. And so you had the monarchy, and the monarchy did what they wanted. As we went along time, suddenly those monarchs had those little royals and those little princes and those little lords or some brothers who revolted. Well, you can't be the only person who takes decisions. We all need to take decisions. So there was a revolt, monarchs were overthrown, new kings came in, whether it was Britain or whether it was France. All over world history you will find monarchs getting overthrown or new centers of power emerging, including India. What were these princes? Finally, the kings and the monarchs said, oh, well, we can't be ruling all alone. Let's give some areas to them. So overall, I shall look after that your borders. So that in case of a war, I shall fight and I collect a tax. Local governance you look after. So it delegated from the monarch down to these princes. But that was still a very feudal system. Everybody didn't have a role in that. We went further in time, and governance then shifted from monarchs and princes to the Greek concept of the city-state. So what did the Greeks do? They built a nice town hall. Let everybody come into the town hall, debate, fight, heated debates, and let's take a decision about what we need to do about the city. And people said, oh, wow, this is participatory. People are getting into decision-making. Everybody is together. Governance has become good. But then they realized that in these town halls, women and slaves were not allowed. Is this participatory? No. Women didn't have a right to vote. Slaves didn't have a right to vote. So therefore, again, this was a higher class of society, though participatory, but not completely participatory. The thought process again started, and you moved on to governance where you said, well, you must have participatory governance. Anybody over a certain age, no matter what his standard in society is, whatever standing in society he has, or his gender, should be allowed to vote and therefore participate in governance. And you moved on to what is called universal voting rights. And everybody who was an adult had a right to vote and select his government, and the governance further shifted. But we didn't stop at that. We went a little further and said, well, governance can't just mean a right to vote, a government which votes and decides what needs to be done. We need to take it further down. We need to decentralize. And therefore, in India, you saw a constitutional amendment which said, well, there will be gram panchayats, there will be municipalities, there will be corporations, they shall elect, they shall have power of taxation, and they shall decide on these subjects, and nobody shall interfere. So you started delegating governance. So see how governance got delegated. It not only got widened, the base got widened. Everybody got a right to vote, but even the decision-making process got delegated. Did governance stop at that? So now you've delegated, you've widened the base. Finally, we can all go home and say, well, things are running well, and things are running fine. So you have the right structures in place. Do we need to do anything more? Then people said, no. Structures is not the only thing. The processes must fall in place. You can't just say, I have the correct structure, but I have wrong processes, and therefore, my governance is correct. No, the processes must fall in place. And when you decided to think about processes in governance, you started looking at concepts of equity, of fairness, of being transparent. Suddenly people said, oh, well, it's a democracy, and therefore 99 people get together. Can they kill that one man? No, you can't. Because finally, in a democracy or in a good system of governance, every little thought, it may not be the majority thought, but that thought has a right, if it is not adverse to society or social good, has a right to thrive, to expand, to convince others to that process. So therefore, we started looking at concepts of equity, of concepts of fairness. Then people said, well, there has to be transparency. You can't just say, well, just because 99 people are taking a decision, and therefore that decision is not a decision which is picking winners. Governance does not mean just because I have been elected, therefore I have the right to pick winners. I have no right to pick winners. The system must decide who the winner is. I have only a right to ensure that the system is such, which is fair, which automatically decides who the winner is through a fair process. I cannot be picking winners. So therefore, it moved into what is called transparency. And when we looked at transparency, there's another thing that's now driving things, and that's technology. Governance is now riding on technology. As technology comes in, transparency is becoming more and more easier. Transparency is becoming something which is available. It's making governance much more effective, much more, you know, the feedback is much better. So the technology came, and the combination of technology and the combination of this fairness, equity, has now moved things. Therefore, now thinking has again changed. The governance is now re-emerging. And two things are driving the re-emergence. One, previously, everything which the government did was actually a privilege. So if the government decided to give its citizens pipe water, oh, well, we've given you a privilege, you see. You voted for me, and therefore you got pipe water. There's a toilet next to your house, it's a privilege. Now people are saying, no, this is my right. There's a huge difference between a privilege and right. To get clean drinking water in my house is a right, it's not a privilege that you give me. To get a toilet near my house is a right. To get a road without a pothole is a right. To have a Mumbai which doesn't flood during monsoons is a right. To have a Mumbai which doesn't have malaria and dengue is no more a privilege, it's a right. So suddenly things have moved. And now of late, what are the governments talking? A right to service act. A right to service. Service was always a privilege. It's a privilege that I serve you. Now they're saying, no, service is not a privilege. It's the right of the citizen. So now there's a right to service act, where in governance you can go and say, well, my birth certificate, you are a custodian of my birth certificate. You shall give me my birth certificate, which is correct and true within 7 days of my application. It's no more a privilege that you come to me, beg me, and then I shall give it to you. No, it's your right. It should be given. And this right, together with technology, is now driving governance, just moving governance in an absolutely different direction, a direction which, you know, those old bureaucrats like us are still trying to, you know, gasp and find our bread to keep pace with this, with the way it's moving. As we move on with technology, even people's thinking and the way people desire services to be delivered is changing. The first change that we notice now is that people don't want to interact with the government. And technology is now affording you a methodology of getting what you want or what is your right without interacting with the government. You ask anybody, not in just in Mumbai, you ask anybody in London, ask somebody in Mumbai, do you love Mumbai? Oh yeah, I love Mumbai. Do you love the corporation? No. Would you like to stay in Mumbai? Oh yes, I would stay in Mumbai, a beautiful city. Would you like to come and meet somebody in the corporation? No. Why this? Well, it's this. This is a reality. And this reality is now being driven by technology. So if you need a birth certificate, you don't need to come to the corporation. Please download it and take it. You need a license to run a restaurant. Please don't come. Do it online. You need some other issue. You need a building proposal. You do it online. And so governance is now emerging to not just being a right. It's also emerging to being delivered without what you latest management jargon calls as without a touch point. People don't want a touch point. And that's where governance is now moving. People want it at home. They don't want to come to you. That's one way that is, and that's one thing that we've done with the building proposals. We've said you don't need to come to us. Please upload it. The computer will analyze your building plan with the auto DCR. We will see what is wrong. We shall inform you. As your file moves up, it shall move online. You shall get an SMS, and you shall finally see it on the console what the remark was, including what the commissioner wrote on your file. You're moving everything there. Second thing, people don't want to be told what is exclusively within their domain of decision making. Simple things. So I was looking at, when I was in the electricity sector, I was looking at redevising the form for applying for an electricity connection. Had an interaction with citizens. One youngster sitting there suddenly asks me, why do you ask me date of birth for giving me an electricity connection? I really didn't know why I asked him. So then he very jokingly turns around and says, oh, do you intend sending me a happy birthday card? No. Or giving me free electricity for that month where I was born? No. Do you say that you won't give me an electricity connection if I'm less than 18 years? No, the law says anybody who is a citizen of India is entitled to an electricity connection. Will you not give me an electricity connection if I'm 80 years old? No, it says any living person is entitled. Then why? People don't want to be asked why. Please ask me information that's necessary. Don't ask me information that's not necessary. Similarly, please don't get into the domain where I'm supposed to make a decision. Simple things. In Mumbai Corporation, we had a grade which I had seen as a child when I came into Mumbai. Restaurants used to be graded. Grade A restaurant. Grade B or grade 1, grade 2 restaurant. Who are you to say this is grade A? If I don't like the food, damn it, it's a useless restaurant. I'm not eating here. If the restaurant is good, whether it is vada pav, it's grade A. Street food is grade A if I love street food. If I don't love street food, it may be grade D, grade E, whatever. We've removed grading. And people are extremely happy with that. Why should we grade it? I am only supposed to look after that the restaurant maintains a sanitary condition, is clean and healthy, serves you wholesome food, which is not infected, that's it. So governance is now moving and technology is now driving it. And that's where we see huge, huge changes coming in. Other thing that you see in governance that's coming in a big way is predictability. People want to know that if I applied for a restaurant license, will I get it or will not I get it? Environment clearances. For example, I was environment secretary. People would come and sit in a particular direction. I said, aise kyun baithe ho? Wo humko bataya gaya ki uttar ki taraf dekhenge to vastu theek hai, mere ko mil jayega certificate. Nahi bhai. These are the 5 things. If you comply with it, you will get your environment clearance. Please don't discharge any polluted water into a river. Please don't have anything discharging into the air which is beyond this. Please don't make noise beyond 50 decibel. If you are complying with those requirements, why should you not get it? You don't have to look to the north and have your vastu correct to get your environment clearance. No. So suddenly people are saying, please bring predictability in what you do. If I apply, will I get it or will I not get it? Should be available to me that minute I apply it. That's another aspect of governance that's coming in. And therefore now you find that in the government, we are coming out with SOPs. We are coming out with questions that we should ask. We are coming out with clear things. Your application shall be rejected if you did this and shall be approved if you did that. So when you apply, then itself you will know you will get it or you shall not get it. Predictability is another issue that's coming up in governance. As we move along with this, what comes to my mind is what are the future challenges? Governance is throwing up. It's a very dynamic. You know, finally now you realize that governance is not something which is static. The concept, the structure, the process, people's thinking, what people want is not static, it's dynamic, it's moving. What are the challenges that are coming up? The first challenge that comes to my mind is, there are services, which I'll use the word right and not a privilege anymore. There are services which are a right as mandated in the law. Now, if you look at the MCGM Act, the Municipal Corporations Act, Mumbai Municipal Corporation Act, it defines mandatory duties. So, for example, it says, primary health care is mandatory duty of the corporation. It says, primary education is mandatory duty of the corporation. That means that we in the corporation are supposed to look after what is called public health issues. So there shall be no dengue. You shall see that malaria doesn't happen. Cholera, typhoid is not there. Water is clean. So these are public health issues. But providing a bypass surgery, doing an angioplasty, doing a liver transplant, is that a mandatory duty? No. The corporation can very well turn around and say, well, we're looking after primary duties. We don't look after this. Can you do that? Even though it's not mandated, it's not a right, it's not a service that comes as a right. Can you now in this modern day and age turn around and say that, well, if you are poor, we shall not let you die of malaria, but you may die of because you can't afford a bypass. No, you can't. So therefore, you have corporation hospitals now getting into specialized care, secondary healthcare and tertiary healthcare. But where do you draw these lines? You simply cannot leave complete healthcare into the private sector, into the hands of the private sector, because the poor will get eliminated. Also, equally speaking, you can't take over the whole secondary healthcare. Somewhere you need to draw a line. Now, that's a challenge in governance. Where do you exactly draw the line? To what extent do you go? And therefore, we are running these teaching hospitals. Do you know Mumbai Corporation spends 3,500 crores on health every year? That's because we do a lot of tertiary work. We're doing some of the latest cutting-edge medical technology and research in our hospitals, which is actually not mandated for the corporation to do. But where do you actually draw this line? It's a challenge. It's something that we try to grapple with on an everyday basis. The second challenge that seems to be emerging is the challenge between managing the micro and managing the macro. I'll give you a simple example of the coastal highway. So when I took the coastal highway for approval to the body and said, well, we're going to set up the coastal highway and this is what it's going to cost. And there was one corporator who asked me a very, very relevant question. So he said in Marathi, hey, coastal highway ta tumhi karayla nigala, maja gharchi samorchi gallichi khadde tari baga. Yes, correct. It's correct. That's an issue that needs to be dealt with. Now, are you going to put all your money into this or putting all your money into removing those khaddas in that gully? Similarly, when the sewage treatment project plants, STPs, today in Mumbai, we are in a sad situation, let's admit, out of about 3,700 million liters of water that we supply every day, that's the drinking water quantity that we supply every day, about 25 to 2,600 million liters of water are being discharged into the sea untreated. Look at the condition of the sea. What have we done? We need to put up these STPs immediately. But what is the question that some people ask? And it's right. It's not something that we can laugh about. Is that, oh, well, you talk about STPs costing about 10,000 crores, but do you know the slum that I live in has water which comes only for 3 hours and that too at night? Sort that out first before you talk about STPs. Yes, correct. But where do you now draw the line between a macro issue and a micro issue? Both are needed by society. Both cost you money. There is a line that needs to be drawn, and that's, again, a civic governance issue, a civic governance challenge which we need to think of and decide what you need to do. The third issue that comes up, and these are issues which you never thought of, issues of poverty. You know, poverty was something, a word which was only associated with rural. People thought of rural poverty. And rightly so, because rural poverty actually meant hunger. It meant people sleeping without food. Because employment in rural areas was an issue, is an issue. If the rains fail, the failure of rains is not just failure of crops. It means starvation. Unless government steps in with those employment guarantee works, it actually means unemployment, it actually means starvation. Whereas in urban areas, it's not that. Poverty has a very different connotation and meaning in urban areas. It means lack of housing. In rural areas, there's no lack of housing. All you did was had a nice thatched hut and you slept inside it while you slept hungry. But yes, you had a little roof over your head. But in urban areas, housing is an issue in which is the fundamental issue which separates the rich from the poor. If you're poor, you have a full stomach, but you're sleeping on the footpath. Urban poverty is an issue. How do you tackle with that? So suddenly now, corporations and civic governance is talking of housing. Till date, what did we say? Housing is for the private sector to do. It's for you to look after. Your own house, please go take a loan, buy it and build your house. But now we are saying, well, urban areas are engines of growth. People are migrating to urban areas for employment, better health conditions, better schools. But these things are better, but then the housing is bad. Can the government or civic governance say, well, housing is not my task. You live a poor man, sleep on the footpath, have good education, good medical, stomach full, but you're on the footpath. No, it doesn't happen anymore. That's another issue. How do you deal with poverty and urban poverty? And that's a huge, huge challenge, dealing with housing. It's an important issue in urban areas. The other thing that's happening in urban areas is quality of life. That's another challenge. Earlier, if a corporation provided water, clean drinking water, lit up the streets at night, swept the roads, picked up your garbage, it was a good corporation. But now people say, no, that's not enough. What is the quality of life here? Do we have theaters? Do we have entertainment areas? Are there enough open spaces? Are there gardens for my children to play? Are there places where the old people can go? Are your footpaths safe to walk? The issues are changing. It's not just provision of those four, five things of garbage, lifting water, and things like that. No, it's going much beyond that. Quality of life is a serious governance issue in civic areas. That's a serious, serious challenge that we are looking at and facing. While we talk of these things, two things become important, and important challenges too. One is finance. Finally, if you need to fund and ensure that poverty is removed, you need to see that quality of life goes up. You need to see that macro and micro issues both are met. You need finances. Urban finance is becoming an issue. And the big debate that came up during the GST was, what do you do with urban finance or city governance finance? Because octroi was one big source. In the Mumbai corporation, for example, we collected 7,200 crores. That was the kind of money that we collected, and this was used for these purposes. Now, suddenly, a major source of financing the corporation is going, a LBT, local body tax. It was going away. What do you do with this? But let me say the government looked at that issue. Seriously, government also realizes that as we give more and more responsibilities to corporations, as people migrate to the cities, we need to finance them correctly, and therefore now you have a sharing formula which has been very fair, so that the GST that's collected by the government is shared. Mumbai Corporation, for example, our 7,200 crores stand protected. Every year we shall get that money. We shall also see a growth, compounded growth of 8% in perpetuity, and that money is guaranteed through a sovereign guarantee to come every month. So that's the challenge that we are dealing with. How do you keep maintaining and sustaining the financial resources of the government? And lastly, what's important is capacity building. All these challenges and emerging challenges, is the corporation employee, is the commissioner himself capable of dealing with this? Are we building capacity somewhere? Are we training them? Are we making them think in a more forward way? Are we making them do things correctly? Capacity building is a huge issue. In Mumbai Corporation, we realize this. We are, in fact, with the help of Mr. Jha, setting up a special center for capacity building, urban capacity building. How do you make a development plan? In fact, when I came in here, the first task that was given to me was that we need to get a development plan going. I was actually at a loss. Who do I talk to? Is there somebody? Is there a consultant? Is there somebody who can come and sort of help us? No, there's nobody. There's just no capacity available. Thankfully, Mr. Jha came along. I requested him. He built capacity in the corporation. He's managed to train people like More, Khanda, all these people sitting here. He built capacity. And then we were able to, over 1 year, get the development plan going. Now, this is the condition of Mumbai. Think of what's happening in Nasik, Sholapur, Kolhapur, small little towns like Amaravati. capacity building in urban management, urban development plan, urban systems, urban service delivery is a very important thing. But when you think of capacity building, you're thinking of capacity building of only the service provider, the corporation and its employees. Are we looking at capacity building for the citizens? Now, as you provide modern services, we're also expecting citizens to perform his duties, simple things. While coming today, on the bus stop, bang in front of the bus stop, there's a car that is parked. Are we a responsible citizen? And the bus is now occupying a lane that is supposed to run for the vehicles. I was there in BKC for a meeting with the parliamentary committee, and on the way back, I just saw, just before the ceiling starts, two dumpers have dumped debris from a house over there. So what are we saying? Citizens have to contribute, and there are two, three ways of in which the citizens contribute. One is voluntary service. People come out and say, well, today is a Sunday, we shall all collect together and clean the beach. It's a voluntary effort. Everybody comes, cleans the beach, you put in your physical labor, you put in your time, you clean it. Second way of contributing to the city is youngsters like them come forward and say, well, we've got young ideas, we've got disruptive ideas, and it's very nice to have disruptive ideas. Can we not give it to you? Yes, please. These are forums which help us collect these disruptive ideas, reap these nascent ideas. So that's the second way. The third way is where citizens become regulators. So when you are redoing your house and you get a transport contractor to transport the debris away, do we ever ask the transporter, ki tum ye debris kahan le jaake daloge? No. What do we ask him? Kitna paisa loge? He says, 2,000. Arey, wo to 1,000 rupay wala bolta hai. He says, theek hai madam, usse karwa lo. 1,000 rupay wala raat ko leta hai, ceiling ke upar dalta hai aur nikal jata hai. Are we compliant? Are we looking at regulations? No, we are not. Can we not tell him, tere ko 2,000 rupay dunga, par tu mere ko certificate la ke dikha ya photo dikha ki ye truck ne mera debris wahan dumping ground mein empty kiya, raste ke upar ya mangrove mein nahi pheka. So we ourselves can become implementers of the law through indirect means. Are we green enough? Are we ensuring that the city is managed? Do we ever tell our driver, don't honk? No. In fact, somebody was telling me, can't we put in a chip? So then you honk for 10,000 times, and after that, you buy another chip. But why do this? Can't a citizen himself tell his driver, hey, yaar, signal red hai, kahe ko horn bajane ka? Wo jab green hoga, tabhi chalegi na gaadi. Can we not become regulators? So we need capacity building in the citizens too. It's not just the service provider, but the service taker also, where capacity building needs to be done. Finally, let me say that this has been a great effort, and the students have done a great job, and I must really acknowledge Burgess, and I must also mention Burgess, your idea about permeability of open spaces has also led to us to changing the law. And now, in Mumbai, RGPG, the difference we have removed. And I must acknowledge that credit goes to you. We've said earlier in the RG, we used to allow a certain amount of construction, and people built clubs, and people built little yoga halls, and meditation centers, and finally it became private property. Now we've said RGPG shall remain open. No construction at all. So a lot of people come to me and say, sir, yoga kahan karenge? Maine kaha aasman ke niche. Ye idea kahan se aaya? Burgess ne diya. It's there. He said, the only thing that we shall allow you on an open space is going to be a toilet and a chowkidar shed, nothing more. That's it. That's the end of the story. It's very clear, and we've written it in the law. I must acknowledge what Rupa has done about judicious use of space. In fact, that's a great idea that Rupa, you've given us. You know, in the corporation, we charge a tax called the LUC. It's called the land under construction. So the minute you get an open plot and you get an IOD from us and a CC and you begin construction, you have to pay a tax on that land. And are you aware that tax is 7 times the amount that you would have paid if the flat was completed? So a lot of these builders come to me and say, sir, khali land ke upar tax 700 rupay और जो फ्लैट बन जाते हैं वो सारे फ्लैट का टैक्स सिर्फ 100 रुपए, ये क्यों? सो आई वुड टर्न अराउंड एंड टेल देम, ये इसलिए सो दैट लैंड इज नॉट अ कमोडिटी दैट यू कैन स्पेक्यूलेट ऑन. लैंड इज अ कॉमन रिसोर्स, इट्स अ कॉमन, इट शैल बी ब्रॉट इन टू हाउसिंग एज सून एज पॉसिबल एंड देयरफॉर हायर टैक्सेशन टू पुश यू इन टू हाउसिंग. So they very cleverly went back and said, fair enough, you want us to do that. We'll build the flat, but lock them and keep them. You've given me an idea. We will see now that empty flats are taxed. So that the house actually comes into the housing market. So we taxed land, but we never thought of taxing flats. And people said, fair enough, mat do. Hum flat lock karke rakhte hain. Usko jab bhav milega, to chhodenge. Now we will say, fair enough, you want to keep an empty flat? Please pay a tax. If you put it on rent, hire, sell it, we have nothing to say. But finally, as a government or as the city government, our role is to ensure that housing stock goes up. We are not here to ensure that you can speculate and speculate well. That's not an issue with us. The Darpana Bhagat, your idea of culture in the city, let me tell you, that's also struck a chord with us. And we are looking at culture and places of art, places where people can go and enjoy in a big way. If you see, we've started looking at the textile museum, and I've told my people that textile museum is not something which somebody who understands textile can go there. It has to be a place where people can come and participate in art, can be a part of it. You know, you can actually see how a sculptor works. You can actually see how somebody does a pencil sketch. You can actually see somebody doing a painting and, you know, sort of learn with him. That's something that we are looking at. Including, we've opened up our traffic islands. We are telling people, if you've made a good sculpture, if you made a piece of art which you think should be put up on a traffic island, please come, most welcome, do it. If you want to put your phone number and name there, please do it. Let that young artist be known. Why not? We are creating spaces where we are saying, well, if the youngsters would just like to come along and play a musical instrument, which everybody can come and sort of enjoy it, please come along and do it. So culture as an important aspect of planning, as an important aspect of governance, after you said that and it's put in the DP, and there's now a whole chapter on this in the DP, it's found a place. What I mean to say is that these ideas that come from youngsters are important and need to find a place, and need to not only find a place but also get converted into policy, into an actionable policy. Finally, a society grows only because of disruptive ideas. Status quos like us have never helped anything grow. We will ensure that status quo remains. People like you help that, and all of you all are welcome. I'm so happy that you all took part in this. Before I close, I must acknowledge with a lot of humility that a lot of my speech came from ideas that Mr. Jha gave me. So everything that I speak here is not the original. The pearls are from him. Only the thread is from me. Thank you so much.